Well, welcome to this video about my web app. You should think about this as being complementary to the other videos, which is about the open source software package. Concepts are the same and some of the code is shared. So this video is really to show you that it's not very complicated to analyze these data online. You wouldn't have to install the code. And it also gives you a pretty quick visual feedback on whether a site is very good. So just to show you the things that you can do here, first of all, if you want a refresher on what the website app is doing, I've put some key concepts here about what's returned by the web app. The main thing we're looking for is to take this GPS or GPS SNR data where the direct signal has been removed, and we want to estimate this periodicity. And so this is a sample periodogram. And we want to do that for all the visible satellites over a reflection area that you are going to set. This happens to be one in Boulder, Colorado, where we're using everything. And this section that's missing is simply because there are no satellites rising or setting there. And the returns are this periodogram plot, this quality control plot, but there's also, there's also a plain text or a comma separated value return as well. There's also a lengthy or an attempt at a lengthy description of the API itself so that you could call this from the command line if you wished to do that. So let's just do a pretty quick, simple station. Let's use one of these examples here. So these have been hardwired, if you will, for a day of year. Let's pick Upper Thwaites Glacier. We hit the submit. What comes up is a Google map, which here is not very good because it's in Antarctica, a photograph if it does exist, and then these raw periodograms. Here I'm using the L1 frequency. I'm using all potential azimuths, and the average reflector height is 5.3 meters. And below this is a plot that shows you the retrievals. Here are the retrievals across the azimuth, so you can see that it's very consistent, which if you look at it, you can believe that on an ice sheet, you might have very consistent retrievals. There does, in this particular photograph, which is not on the same day as the data, there's a lot of mess here, but that's probably because the field crew was there. What's also shown here are the amplitudes of those periodogram retrievals and another quality control value. If you actually just wanted to look at the numerical results, those would be here. And again, that's year, day of year. The reflector height is here in this third column. So that's your introduction to what can be done with this. Let me give you another example where I'm gonna use a site that can be used for tides. I'm just gonna set some parameters. I'm setting the maximum and minimum reflector height. Let's set that to 10. I'm going to try to show you L2C, which is a far better frequency than L2. I'm going to set the elevation angles here. And I'm going to change the azimuths. You don't have to do that if you don't want to. I happen to know that the data are at UNAVCO, so I'm just going to send that. And again, the web app doesn't immediately submit an answer because it has to go get the data, it has to go get the orbits and things like that. So unlike the example for Thwaites Glacier in Antarctica, here we don't have retrievals in all azimuths because I restricted it, but those that we do have are quite clearly significant, but you'll notice a difference. For Thwaites Glacier, the periodograms bunched up at the same value. And in fact, when we looked at the azimuth here on the x-axis in the previous example, they were all lined up at the same reflector height value. Here you see some variability, and the reason you see the variability is you're measuring tides. So at this particular time, which is stored in the file, the reflector height is a little bit above 4. At another time, it's above 6. Again, reflector height's the distance between the antenna, which is shown here, and the water. And you can back out the tides by looking at that because we give you the time here in UTC values. The other thing I would just point out to you is that if you have a Rhinex file that's compliant with the rules, which is shown right here, which means you have to name it in a way I like, lowercase, you have to either use GZ or Unix compression or not compressed at all, a four character station name and things like that. You can also submit your own Rhinex files. You don't have to use the archives. So I think I'll stop there. This is just to give you an introduction to how the website works. And I hope you'll give me some feedback on that.